rises in Wagner's opera Valkyrie. In the center of the stage is the stem of a mighty ash tree whose roots spread far over the ground. Bedded into the tree is a sword that this character Sigmund will eventually remove after declaring his love for his own sister. A trend in the Ring cycle in which Wagner's characters can make physical changes in reality through sincere emotional declarations. In fact, heartfelt expositions have the power to change the entire world. The idea that a character can make an announcement and subsequently something happens. I shouldn't say subsequently. Consequently, something happens that makes the world a different place. First happens in the opera prior to Valkyrie, and that's in the Rheingold. In the opening of the Rheingold, a dwarf named Alberic comes across three nymphs who are guarding the Rheingold. He makes a series of advances, sexual advances, towards them, in which they continue to refuse him over and over again, and they mock him and they kick him. And they make sport of his lustful advances. And not thinking about it, they explain that only the person who renounces love can seize the Rheingold that they're guarding. Only the person who renounces love. Now, the exact words are, he who shall passion's might forswear, he who from loving shall forbear, alone the magic shall master the ring to shape of the gold. That's what the one of the Rhine maidens says to Alberic. And what we're about to play is the first of, you know, well, not the first, one of many of Wagner's leitmotifs. This is the renunciation motif. Now, the exact words in German are this: Nur wer der Miene macht entsagt, nur wer der Liebe Lust verjagt. So you listen to the words. The words that rhyme are Mina and Liebe. Mina is like an old-fashioned form of chivalric love. We don't really have a word for that in English. And then the next word is Liebe, which is the ordinary German word for love. And Alberic responds by saying, though love were denied me, yet cunning would quiet my lust. And as he makes this declaration that love is denied him, therefore he can renounce love, we hear the renunciation motif yet again, this time purely in orchestral form. So Alberic proceeds to renounce love, and when he does, the Rhine maidens go into a frenzy, and he seizes the Rheingold that he subsequently forges into a ring. However, in the second act, Alberic is tricked, and he is kidnapped, and Wotan steals the ring, and as that happens, he curses it. Why does Alberic have the power to do these things? We might ask. And I think the implication is that Wagner is making is that the scale of Wotan's betrayal in seizing a ring that, you know, Alberic in that scene tells him it means a lot to him, that the scale of Wotan's betrayal engenders feelings in Alberic that grant him that power to issue the following curse. So we start to see that this individual, who's a random person as far as we know, who just wandered onto the stage at the beginning of the Rheingold, has the ability to make these outpouring declarations that curse the entire world. When he curses the ring, he says, the whole world will sense its presence and seek it. This is an origin story of greed in the world. So in Wagner's Ring universe, then, an ordinary dwarf brings greed into the world via a curse. He's not a god. And yet his curse carried this weight. So I think that's very significant. So moving back to the stage in Valkyrie, we got our tree in the middle of the stage. Siegmund has wandered into somebody else's house and he meets his long lost twin sister. That's what's going on. As we get this scene that unfolds between Siegmund and Sieglinde, he discovers that there's a sword embedded into the tree. That, as we described in the beginning, the tree that's in the middle of the stage. But in order to pull the sword out, we hear the renunciation theme yet again. Let's hear it. This is from Siegmund now. This moment is an inversion of what had already happened in Rheingold. Alberic renounced love in order to seize the gold. This is an announcement of love by Siegmund in order to acquire the sword. Yet again, though, what binds these moments is that the sincerity of a heartfelt declaration causes something to physically manifest itself, causes a physical possibility. The point he seems to be making, it's almost like when you have a sincere feeling in your heart, in a perfect world, it would supersede all practical exigencies. The true, honest feelings that you have should rescind all other considerations if the world was a perfect place. In this situation, just so we're summing up here, he's wandered into a home and fallen in love with his twin sister, who is married to another man. And this sword that he has plucked from the tree is the sword he's going to use against her husband, hopefully, and hopefully win. The duel between Siegmund and her husband Hundig has already been scheduled before he plucks this sword out. And so Act 1 of Valkyrie ends with this incestuous embrace, and we head up to Valhalla, where we find Wotan having a conversation with one of his other offspring, that is Brunhilde. Brunhilde is a Valkyrie. Valkyries are like warrior maidens. They're all the daughters of Wotan that, with various mothers that, you know, he's been cheating on his wife. So he has a conversation with Brunhilde. He instructs her to go down to Earth and help Siegmund win this duel. And Brunhilde's attitude towards this, by the way, is one of great enthusiasm. She is ready to go. Listen to her here. This is some glass shattering shit right here. But at the end of this scene, she still has to bolt because she hears Wotan's wife approaching, Fricka. And she's got an argument with her husband. Sieglinde's husband has prayed to her, and she has come to intercede and say, "Look, I'm the goddess of matrimony. These two have offended it, and I'm asking you to stay out of this fight. Let it happen. Let it happen as it will." Which means necessarily, of course, that Siegmund is going to have to be killed. Because it means that Wotan has to undo the fact that he had deliberately planted the sword there. But here's what's irritating: you can easily start to get sick of the emotionalism of Wagner, hour after hour. So, as these two get into a fight, Wotan's argument is, "Oh, but the spring has united them, and ardent magic entranced them." And the fact that she's married, unholy always the vow, is what Wotan says, that joins those who lack love. She's in a loveless marriage, therefore her marriage doesn't matter. Whereas Siegmund and Sieglinde have a connection of true old-fashioned Mina, true old-fashioned chivalric love, and he can see for himself with his own eyes that it is heartfelt and sincere. And when Fricka responds to this, her argument is to accuse him of hypocrisy, to accuse him of having no moral ground to stand on as someone who has rejected his own marital vows. So her argument to him is that it is an emotional one rooted in her own betrayal and her own jealousy. She can't just make a reasonable point. No one ever makes, you can look in vain for an adult throughout the ring cycle. If you're hoping for Fricka to say what a rational person would say, Fricka wouldn't even argue with him. She would step into the situation and say, "Great, they're in love with each other. I believe it. I believe that they really feel it. But you know what? Tough. They're siblings, and she's married. So they can be in love all they want. Tough shit. Nope, she doesn't say that. She has to pursue this emotional tact where she attacks her husband for his own infidelities. It can get frustrating for any kind of logical audience member to watch Wagner and see this. It's like Wagner's fantasizing about a world in which reality itself and all the other people in it can see how strongly you feel about something and act accordingly. It's very childish. It's amazing that this was written by an adult, and it's even more amazing that there's no doubting the genius of it. So now we have to move into the next scene. Brunhilde is dispatched. She is instructed by her father to make sure that the sword is broken in the middle of the duel or beforehand, which will, of course, result in Siegmund's death. She has to do this, and she knows that the reason she has to do this is because Fricka has won that previous argument. So she goes down there begrudgingly to enforce this wish, and she has a conversation with Siegmund beforehand. She explains everything to him with no small amount of bedside manner, quite frankly. Siegmund is understandably distressed about his pending death, but she consoles him with information about the afterlife that awaits him, which is Valhalla, where he is going to be tended to by Valkyries, beautiful warrior women. She makes it sound quite nice. But the wrinkle comes from the fact that he's going to have to leave Sieglinde behind. He doesn't want to do that. And all the worse, her husband's going to get the chance to kill him in battle. And then as he's dead, she's going to go back to being this guy's wife. That doesn't sound like a fun proposition to him. But he throws this temper tantrum. Listen to this music, this temper tantrum music, when his response is that if he's going to have to die, he's not going to go to Valhalla. He's going to go to hell. That's how serious he is. That's how strongly offended he is by this outcome. Listen to the temper tantrum music here. Don't you feel like you're just waiting for the door to slam? Like he's an ungrateful little teenager running upstairs? Dun, 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 dun. It's just, he's such a, ch everybody in this opera is a child. There are no adults. So what she says next is, wow, is this woman really that big of a deal? So apparently that's a callous question that she has posed to him. And his response is, so young and fair, you shine to my eyes, yet how cold in heart, my heart recognizes you. So he accuses her of being an unfeeling maid for not being able to spot how sincere his love is and not being able to know the true emotional ramifications of what she's asking of him. Erkennst du mein Herz, he says. My heart recognizes you as being cold and hard. And she responds, here we get the reaction. Oh, I didn't know you felt so strongly. It's almost like Wagner's fantasize. It's like when someone loses an election, a presidential election in America, and people say they're going to move to Canada. It's almost like they're hoping everyone else in the country is going to say, oh man, I didn't realize you felt so strongly. In that case, your person wins. And yet that's exactly how this conversation with Brunhilde is going to go. So this is what she says. I see your despair, she responds. Ich sehe die Not, die das Herz dir zernagt. I can see the pain that's growing in your heart. She's having the reaction in this Wagner fantasy world where everybody can understand each other's inner feelings. So she's getting closer to being swayed by his emotional outpourings, but just in case she's not convinced, he's ready to show her he means business. And in this next moment, he raises the sword over Sieglinde and is prepared to kill the love of his life and his own twin sister, proving how strongly he feels. And this is the moment where Brunhilde truly intercedes and agrees to take his side in the coming duel. Listen to the elevated tension in this moment. And when her voice pops in at the end, that's her jumping in before he can kill this girl. But of course, none of this matters because Wotan comes down and makes sure that Siegmund loses. And so Siegmund dies. And then Act 3 begins pretty nonchalantly and forgettably. But if you think that moment is going to presage some massive incident on the stage, it really doesn't. What follows is an old man with a spear chasing a bunch of girls around a stage. It's all that takes place right after that. So as Act 3 continues, though, we get one last apparatus that a person with the right feelings in their heart we'll find those feelings acknowledged by the physical world. And that is Wotan decides to put his daughter Brunhilde to sleep. And only someone who is without fear is going to be able to burst through the flames that he is going to set around her. And this is the music that accompanies that moment. And we hear Siegfried's theme predicting who it will be. And that, you know, that will come in the third opera in the Ring cycle. So that is how it ends. So just a few remarks on all of this, because there's been a ton of ink spilt over Wagner and the fact that Adolf Hitler had him as his favorite composer, and that Wagner had written a pamphlet that was against Jewishness in the arts. And so we wonder, you know, as listeners in the modern world, whether or not, you know, we're allowed to like Wagner. What is it about Wagner that made Hitler like him? And so there's a deal of hand-wringing that surrounds Wagner. But to me, the anti-Semitism, that is just one manifestation of authoritarianism. To me, it is these agonizing pleas for other people to acknowledge the sincerity of the strongest feelings that are in your heart, and to be in a position hoping that someone will hear you, that the world will hear you, that people will hear you, or the gods, and gratify those innermost feelings. To me, that is the constant. Anti-Semitism is a variable. That emotional state of mind, authoritarian forces can change their shape to fill that. And they offer transcendence to troubled souls. So you have to admire the genius of Wagner, because he is a genius. This is some of the greatest music ever written. But you just have to remember that there's something a little bit dangerous in this. And if actually there's one thing great about it, is it offers for posterity some insight into the pathology that sometimes takes us down the wrong path.